Hey guys, welcome to Seining Fun. Today we will be looking at fish, reptiles, amphibians found in the wetland. But quickly, we'll see our my two wonderful teammates, Carly and Rihanna, seining. So as they pull them out of the water, they are going to find what creatures we have found in this little pond here today. So it looks like when they pulled it out, they found some minnows, they have found some tadpoles, and let's see they found a little crayfish. Before we get started here, guys, today I would like to welcome you to the beautiful Herb and Kebble wetland. We have been conducting research throughout the week to see how healthy our wetland has been. Wetlands hold a variety of creatures such as reptiles, amphibians, and fish, and many more different wonderful creatures inside a wetland. Inside a wetland, creatures need food, water, shelter, and space. So guys, I'm talking about the fish section today, so we can find plenty of fish found in a wetland and across southwestern Ontario. So we can find smallmouth bass, largemouth bass, carp. I can name a bunch of species that we can find inside the wetland. But the problem is, if we only have one type of fish species and they're all the same size, they're not going to survive. We need many, many types of fish found in the wetland for it to be healthy. Or else we know that something's going wrong in the wetland, or like pollutant or invasive species have taken it over. Thing on the side here we call the pelvic fin. We have the pectoral fin, which helps them, which is all these fins are helping them swim and how they move around the water. There's different types of fish that have different shapes to them, but we call this the dorsal fins. Right here at the top of the fish, you'll see them. The back of the two fins at the back, we call the caudal fin, which is known as the tail as well. We more look at their characteristics. So we'll look about how their fins are shaped, the colors they have, if they have stripes, spots, how their mouth is shaped, do they have barbels here. So here today, we have some wonderful fish found in our tank. And as I'll try to catch them here, they're very fast. Brigo.
2 hours later.
Alright guys, looks like I have a little smallmouth bass here. Very, very sharp dorsal fin as I try to pull him out here. But I will try to get his measurement. Alright, so as I put my smallmouth bass on the scale here, you can see he is about 7.5 inches here. He looks very, very healthy here today. So as we see here, we have the very sharp dorsal fins. You see those spikes on top. You have the very nice pattern here. Small, small fins. And I'll get my net here and try to get, hopefully, a sunfish or the bluegill. Bluegill.
2 hours later.
So our fish here today is 15 centimeters exactly. Not a very big guy, but he is very, very healthy here. Doesn't have as sharp of fins on top, but he is very squirmy here today. But very, very healthy fish. So we can guess that this wetland is very healthy, knowing that our fish have been very healthy. So we hope today that you pass on our learning opportunity here that we've done with you today, and take on as much and learn about as much fish as you can. So I'm gonna pass it on, who's gonna be talking about amphibians today, is my wonderful teammate, Rihanna.
Hi guys, I'm Rihanna, and today I'll be talking to you about amphibians and frogs. So the amphibians that we have in our wetlands here are like frogs, toads, salamanders, and newts. So I'm first gonna be talking to you about frogs and toads. So they look kind of the same, but they are very different. Frogs like slimy and they're wet. They like to be in the water. toads like dry land. They walk more than they hop, and they don't prefer water, but you can still find them in there. They also have warts on them, but they will not give you warts if you touch them. That is a myth. So because amphibians breathe through their skin, they are a good indicator species of how healthy our wetlands are. So if they breathe through their skin, if there's any pollution, it goes right into their systems, and that's how you can tell if they're sick, if they're deformed, and that's from the pollution in the water because it goes right into their systems. So today with us, we have three different kinds of frogs. We have a green frog, this guy is jumping all right here. That's one of the big ones. They are mostly green. They have a big eardrum right behind their eyes. That's usually a good way to tell. And then we have a wood frog. They have a black line right under their eyes, black and white. And that's a good way to tell about those ones. And then we have a leopard frog. And they have spots all around their backs and their legs. So that's a good way to tell how those are. And just like the leopard frog, we also have spotted salamanders who are covered in spots as well. So they're usually black with yellow spots. There's this guy right here. This is usually about how big they get. He's probably not gonna get any bigger. There's another smaller one in there. And then we have a red-backed salamander in there and a lead-backed. So it's pretty easy to tell the difference between the spotted and the lead and red-backs because the spotted are spotted, the red-backs, they do have red-backs, it's right in the name. And the lead-backs are just an earlier stage of a red-backed salamander. And a fun fact about salamanders is that they actually go and sniff every lily pad in the pond before they go and lay their eggs. And all amphibians' eggs, they lay them in the water, so they spend half of their life in the water, half of it out of the water, and the eggs are covered in a gel substance as opposed to reptiles who lay their eggs on land, which is what Carly will be talking to you about next.
Hey guys, I'm Carly, and like Rihanna said, I'm going to be talking to you about reptiles. So you can find reptiles mostly on land, but like turtles, you can also find them in the water. Turtles, they are ectothermic, which means they do not regulate their own body temperature. So you can find them in the vegetation along our wetland here, or on rocks or logs basking in the sun to warm themselves up. Just like they can't warm themselves up, regulate their own temperature, they also can't cool themselves down. So when they get too hot, they need to go in the shade, which is very important for our vegetation to cool them off. In the winter, turtles do hibernate, and how they hibernate is they go to the bottom of the pond. They do not need to eat, and they slow down their heart rate, and lower their body temperature. When they hibernate, they go to the bottom of the pond, like I said, and that means they do not need to come up to eat, so they're sleeping. And you might be wondering, how do they breathe underwater? Well, let me tell you. They have developed this special tissue in their throat and their tail opening. Their tail opening is also known as their butt. I know, that's super funny. Anyways, that allows them to take the oxygen in from the water, and they are sleeping, so they don't need to come up to eat. And that is how they hibernate. After they are done hibernating, they come up to the surface, and they find their mate to reproduce. After they reproduce, the female is ready to lay her eggs, and she will go somewhere, crossing roads, going through to find the perfect soil that is easy to dig up, as well as has the perfect moisture in the soil to incubate her eggs. After she lays her eggs, she actually leaves them. So they are very vulnerable to predators such as raccoons and skunks. And so we don't know how many eggs are going to be left because there's no parental guidance after she lays them. So she doesn't even come back to see if they hatched. So we want to make sure that however many eggs are there, stay that way. We want to protect the females crossing the roads by keeping them going in the same direction because they know where they want to lay their eggs. Turtles we can find here are the snapping turtle as well as our painted turtle. So those are the two common ones around here. And just like turtles, snakes are also ectothermic, which means they do need to regulate they cannot regulate their own body temperature. So you can also find them in the vegetation along here as well as basking on rocks and on logs. They also do hibernate in the winter, so they find little burrows in the ground made from mammals or just holes that have been there, and they stay there all winter. Usually once they find a nice safe space, they do go back to that same hole the next year because they know it's safe and they know they are going to be good. It will last the winter. When they come up, they do find a mate to reproduce. Turtles do lay eggs, but snakes can lay eggs as well as have live babies, which is pretty cool depending on the type of snakes. The most common snake you'll find around here is the garter snake. Jenny will have explained more in detail about them earlier in this video. But we also have a very threatened snake that's endangered. There is like maybe less than 10 of them left. They are the Massasauga rattlesnakes. They're very cool looking. Here's a picture. so we need to protect them as much as we can. The big impact they have on their population is habitat loss. So we have lost a lot of our habitat here in Canada, and we need to continue to keep them safe. Habitat loss is one of the factors, as well as humans. So usually when we see a snake, we get scared of them. And what we want to do is not threaten them, or else they won't threaten us. And that is very important, because sometimes if we see a snake, we might be like, oh, let's get rid of it and do that. But we do not want to do that at all. Just like Nathan said earlier, they do need the four things in. They do need water, food, shelter, and space for a healthy, productive wetland. And here at Herb Kebble, that is provided. We have also saw that our fish are healthy, and our amphibians, like our frogs, were healthy. There was nothing wrong with them, no sickness. We also have lots of vegetation here, which is very important to keep them safe and provide food where their bugs stay. So now if we go and dig deeper into our wetland here, let's head over to Marsh Monsters.